Greetings and welcome back. My name is Carl Ford. I work for the University of Minnesota Extension, and this is our part two of pollination in the vegetable garden. And in this segment, we're going to look at pollination in the family Cucurbitaceae, which includes squash, pumpkins, gourds, watermelon, cantaloupe, and cucumber. And I think that you'll find this to be fascinating. I have. It's just amazing how these different plants have developed strategies for pollination in the world. And we'll look at what aids good pollination, again, review the factors that influence pollination, and then we'll get into how each vegetable is pollinated as part of a repeat from the first one. Again, healthy flowers are a function of healthy plants, which are a function of temperature and plant health. And the same goes for pollinators. The pollinator presence is a function of temperatures that are usually above 60 degrees that they like to, that aids them in, you know, the necessary temperatures for their flight. The lower winds are preferred. They are not able to fly in rain, so that's not good. And mostly, they prefer direct sun. If clouds come over, a number of these pollinators seem to disappear and wait for the sun to come back out. So let's look at some of these different plants that could be in our garden that are in this cucurbit family. We'll look at cucumbers, which come from India, so they're an Asian derivative. Watermelon is derived from South Africa. Muskmelon comes from both Africa and India, and the squash and pumpkin families, genera, are from North and South America. The nomenclature on squash, pumpkins, and gourds is a little confusing, so what I've simplified it just to say that if it's a pumpkin, you can carve it. If it's a squash, you cook and eat it, and if it's a gourd, you simply look at it. Now, these are also warm season herbaceous annuals, and they prefer higher temperatures. They are sensitive to low temperatures and frost, and most of them thrive in temperatures above between 65 and 75. They'll tolerate stuff into the low 80s, but if it starts getting into the 90s, that can stress them. Watermelon prefers a little bit higher temperature range that goes more into the 80s, and they like warmer nighttime temperatures. So if you are experiencing poor fruit set or misshapen fruit, it can be due to a number of factors. Often it's due to poor pollination, which is a function of poor weather inhibiting the pollinating insects from being out and about. And this can come from cold temperatures, high winds, rainy conditions, which then the pollinators will not be active. And if they're not active, then there's not enough pollen transfer to these flower types to create well-formed fruit, or there's not enough to sustain the fruit at all and it aborts. So those are the kind of plants we're working with. They're similar enough that we won't try to separate them too much. We will show flowers of each of the species and talk about their general characteristics. One thing we have to mention is that these flowers, with some minor exceptions, are not hermaphroditic, meaning the flower does not have the male and female complements on one flower. The term for this is monoecious, which basically means we have a flower that functions as a male. It's only its staminate parts are fertile and productive, and another flower that's female, because the only parts of that flower that are productive are the female parts, being the pistil and the stigmatic surface. So let's take a look at some of these flowers. because they're fascinating. So first we'll start with cucumbers. Again, cucumber has monoecious, is monoecious plant, meaning there's staminate male and pistillate female flowers. And you can see these bees looking, working on those different cucumber flowers. One other interesting thing to keep in mind about cucumbers is there are parthenocarpic cucumbers. Now, parthenocarpic is a fruit that will develop without pollination. So the fruit just goes along without having requiring pollination. We'll run into a different kind related to this, a different kind of parthenocarpy that does require pollination to stimulate the development of fruit. But in those cases, and this will be in watermelon, the seeds do not complete development, and so when you open the fruit, as in the case of watermelon, what you'll see are these reduced beginnings of seed development, and not the large black seeds that you would see in a seeded watermelon. So that's an introduction to parthenocarpy, and we'll come back to it a little more when we get to watermelon. So, but the other types of cucumbers are non-parthenocarpic. These would be the gherkins and pickling cucumbers, and they do require pollination. Now, both of these flower types, the male and female, both produce nectar, so they are attractive to bees. But if you remember what the plant looks like, it's a long vine. It doesn't have nearly the flower density that some of our other vegetables have. So under certain conditions, it becomes less attractive to the pollinators because it's inefficient for them to have to go long distances between flowers. So but if this is part of your garden and you have other flowers there, it's really not an issue. That tends to be more of an issue in a commercial setting. These flowers are self-compatible, so you can get self-pollination and cross-pollination. So self-pollination would be pollen that's moved from a male flower on one plant to a female flower on the same plant. Cross-pollination would be pollen from a male flower of a different plant, of one plant, onto a female flower of a different plant. Now, this is what these flowers look like if you look at the diagram. And the one way you can always tell a female flower is it has the developing fruit starting at the base of the flower. So you really can't make a mistake. If the other flower parts that you look at are confusing, you can get much better at it by looking at the fruit and realizing when you see this, basically the fruit forming at the base of the flower, that's a female flower. So you can see here's the fruit of the cucumber in pictorial and diagrammatic form, and that's the female, and there are the large female stigmatic surfaces that need to capture a lot of pollen because all of these cucurbit fruits produce a lot of seeds, and they need a lot of pollen to produce those seeds to get a fully formed fruit. And that will be a theme throughout this. The number of pollen grains is related to the number of seeds produced, and the number of seeds produced is a function of the quality of the fruit. And if you go back to the beginning, the number of pollen grains that appear on the stigmatic surface are a function of the activity and efficiency of the various pollinators. This, to return, you can see here, this is the male flower where the anthers often will combine in a spiral and then untwist. So we can see that here they're formed, they have this small kind of feature here at the top of these anthers that enables you to identify that as a male. Again, here's the female with its large stigmatic surface areas. If you go from the diagram to the picture, again, you can see that top area on the male and the stamens that are at this point pressed together. And here's the female with its large stigmatic surface area receptive to pollen, and it's sticky, and that's why some of these other small sand grains are seen there. If you compare the diagram to the pictures, now you get a good sense of what they look like characteristically when cut down cut through the flower longitudinally and then viewed from above. So there are those two cucumber flowers, the male here on the left and the female on the right. And often these cucurbit flowers will attract a bee, which is a squash bee. And this squash bee has developed a very close relationship with squash, and it's an obligate pollinator, meaning it goes to only squash plants. And one thing that's very interesting, and I encourage you to grow squash just to see this, and that is that the male squash bees will often congregate in the flowers as protective areas overnight. And if you open up these flowers, they only last for one day and they close, but they're a great place for these males to congregate. And here you can see two male squash bees on a male cucumber flower. So here again, you can tell this is a female flower here with this fruit developing and a male here without that. Now we'll move on to the squash pumpkin gourd group. And again, these are also monoecious plants with staminate male and pistillate female flowers. Again, you can see the female here with the expansive stigmatic surface area. The male is a little tougher to see, but you can see we have the same thing. Here's the female with the fruit starting at the base, the large stigmatic surfaces on the female flower, and the compressed at this point anthers of the male flower. And if we remove the petals, you can see again, here's the stigmatic surfaces, and here are the stamens with these areas releasing pollen, and you can see how those stamens that were compressed together in a bit of a spiral are now starting to separate. Again, a different kind of squash where you can see the female here and this typical male part of the flower with no fruit developing at the base. These flowers are a little different, but not much. Again, you have the functional male parts, you have the functional female parts, and all of the pollen grains that land here have pollen tubes that will grow down and fertilize each one of those seeds. And these flowers are also attractive to honeybees if they, as long as they can get as much nutrition as they can, if they don't have another highly nutritious competing flower that will draw them away from these different squash flowers. But as we said, both the male and female flowers have nectaries, and these are therefore attractive to honeybees. Again, part of the quiz, there's the female part of that flower, and this male squash bee that we're talking about, Papanapis, on a male flower. So don't miss the opportunity to see some very, if you will, cool bees in these flowers. Again, here they are on the female flower, and you can see these large stigmatic surfaces here. The muskmelon throws a bit of a curve at us, meaning it's not monoecious, it's andromonoecious. Now what that means is that we have a staminate male flower and we have a complete hermaphroditic female flower. So single males, and the female, instead of having not productive anthers and male parts, now does have productive male parts, and therefore it's now a hermaphroditic flower. So this muskmelon is andromonoecious, to throw you a curve, the andro being the male. And so here, again, we have hermaphroditic and male flowers on the same plant. Both types produce pollen because We have the male flower and we have the complete flower, and both flowers also produce nectar. So on a number of on these muskmelon plants, you can see that we will have the anthers productive here, the stigmatic surface on the interior that is receptive, and then the male plant that just has the anthers. And so here's what that female flower looks like. Here's the male flower, more diminutive. And again, we could point out that whenever you eat a muskmelon, be aware that the pollen tube, the pollen grains had to travel either from here or here to this stigmatic surface of the female. The pollen tubes had to grow down and fertilize each one of these seeds. And we'll repeat it, but the main thing is that you need enough seeds to get a good fruit. And watermelon, it is sort of this in-between between the muskmelon and the cucumbers and the squash, in that it's predominantly monoecious. So it's predominantly with just male flowers and female flowers, although there are some andromonoecious types that exist. And again, the andromonoecious is ones with staminate flowers, so males, and hermaphroditic complete flowers that perform the female function. So this is would be one of those complete flowers here that a native bee is on, and you can see this beautiful fruit that we have here that makes watermelon so attractive. And again, the female flower will show the fruit at the base of the flower, as with all these others. And you can see these beautiful types there. So here's a male flower, and you can see that the anthers, which had been pressed together in a partial spiral, are now beginning to separate. Again, the female flower is just the pistillate flower, with again the fruit forming beneath the flower, and a hermaphroditic flower where the pollen, the anthers are functional as well as the female part, so a complete plant in terms of having both functional male and female flowers. But it's less common, but you can find it in watermelons, less common than on muskmelon. So here are the male flowers, and again, you can tell they're the male flowers because there's no fruit forming here, and you can see the anthers starting to separate. And here's the female flowers again. If we're being redundant, here's the stigmatic surface. Those pollen tubes need to be deposited here, grow down and fertilize. Again, this the female fruit at the base. And what's also interesting here is the male flowers are produced first on these watermelon vines, and the female or perfect flowers will appear later. Sometimes days, sometimes a week or more. And the ratios in these different cucurbits have the male flowers outnumbering the females from 3 or 4 to 1 to 10 to 1. So you can see here's a vine showing that, which shows male flower, male flower, male flower, male flower, female flower, with that ratio of more male flowers than female flowers. Now, we did talk about the cucurbit flowers and how attractive they are to pollinators. They do have nectaries, and therefore they are attractive to honeybees. What's interesting is the female flowers produce a somewhat higher volume of nectar than the males, but the sugar concentration in the males is a little higher. So it's sort of one thing or another. But regardless, you need the bees moving between male flowers and female flowers to accomplish pollination. Again, we mentioned that the flowers are not always that attractive to bees, but that's mostly a density issue. And if there are other things flowering nearby, your bees can move off to those. But in our gardens, that's usually not an issue. Another fascinating thing about these cucurbit flowers is they're very short-lived. They open early in the morning, an hour or two after sunrise. Usually the opportunity is for the pistillate flower and the staminate flower below it, well, they'll open on the same day. So the two contiguous flowers on the vine open on the same day. The stigma is most receptive to pollen in the morning and then becomes less receptive as the day goes on. So there's an optimum pollination window that you want to see in that early morning. Because the flowers will close up, the insect pollination and foraging aspects are mostly accomplished in the morning, and by mid-morning, things start to decrease. Also, the fertility of these flowers decreases rapidly. This is fascinating. The newly opened male flower has about 92% fertility of the viability of the pollen grains just as that flower opens. By the time it closes late in that morning, the viability of the pollen grains has decreased to 75%, and the next day it's all the way down to 10%. So it's important that those plants get pollinated as soon as possible after the flowers open. And so you can see why if you have long runs of rainy, cold weather, then the pollinators are not out, then you will not be getting fruit from these plants. So I guess this is one of the key parts of this, that again, the quality of the fruit is a function of the number of seeds produced in the fruit, and the number of seeds is a function of how many pollen grains were deposited, because you won't get any seed unless you have the pollen grain, one pollen grain per seed. And the pollen grains deposited is a function of how many visits the pollinators make. And the effectiveness of the pollinators is a function of the type of bee. And the squash bees and the bumblebees tend to carry more pollen grains than the honeybees. And so they'll move more pollen onto the stigmatic surface of these different flowers. But it's important to remember that the production of fruit is mandatory. You will get no fruit unless you move pollen from that male flower onto the female flower, or in the case of the hermaphroditic cantaloupe, it still needs insect transfer from the pollen on that flower to the stigmatic surface. And if you only get a few visits from the bees, they won't move enough pollen to create enough seeds to create an acceptably sized quality fruit. So these flowers need multiple visits of pollinators to work and to create fruit. And usually it's in the range of 10 to 12 visits. So if you consider that a watermelon needs at least somewhere in the range of 1,000 pollen grains deposited on its stigmatic surface to produce a healthy fruit, you can see how many visits would have to be managed by any pollinator and how many grains would have to be deposited in each visit. Although the number of pollen grains for pumpkins, cucumbers, and cantaloupe is less in the 350, 300, 400 range, they need those pollen, the pollen deposited on the stigmatic surface of those female flowers to create enough seeds to create a viable fruit. There are a number of different bees that are involved in this. Honeybees will visit all these flowers. Squash bees will visit all these flowers. Bumblebees will visit all of these flowers. And the solitary bees, leafcutters, and some of the other bees will also visit these flowers. So there are a number of pollinators that will visit, although the size, as you get to the smaller pollinators, such as some of the solitary bees, they're going to move less pollen grains than the big fuzzy bumblebees. So we might just spend a second pointing out this specialized pollinator of squash, which is this squash bee, so-called. They're early morning bees. They're adapted to these flowers, and they'll often nest within the squash area. They can, because of the way the vine is created, and there's usually some degree of openings, or the ground in the area is easily accessed. Often these ground nesting squash bees will dig their underground tunnels and create the nectar pollen bread that they lay their eggs on and seal off that chamber, and those will be located within the squash field. So you want to be careful how deep you till. Keep an eye to see if you find these small holes that look like big anthills. So the hole is smaller than you would see with an anthill. I mean, the hole is smaller for the bees. The hole is smaller for the ants than it is for the bees, but it looks somewhat like a larger anthill with the material removed from the tunnel and up around the edge of the hole in a little mound. If you see those, you know that it's likely that squash bees have taken up residence in your garden, and it's something to encourage and keep them wanting to be there. This is what a squash bee looks like. It doesn't really look like a honeybee if you were to compare the two. Here's a number of the squash bees. You can see their abdomens have these hairs between the segments of their abdomen that are white, and so you get this striped appearance. And here they are working on, again, flowers, so you can get another view of what that squash bee looks like. Here it is drinking from the nectaries on this female flower that where you can now, because the petals have been removed, you can see the tongue extended here, reaching right into the nectary, taking up the nectar offered by the squash plants. So in my opinion, it's worth having squash, not just for the squash, but also for the fascinating way that these plants are pollinated, the fact that they're monoecious and have these different male and female flowers that you can see. They're easy to identify, as we said, through the fruit formation on the base of the female flower. And they have an interesting sort of ecology, having a specialized bee pollinator adapted to squash. And I've grown them in my garden, and the pictures you saw in there, some of them, were from my squash flowers where I found my resident male squash bees. So that's a lot of fun to see that in your garden and engage in that kind of wildlife. And so this concludes our vegetable pollination series. And we hope you have a wonderful time exploring the fascinating parts of what's happening in your vegetable garden, as well as enjoying the fruits that come from it.